All of you are welcome. I'm Engineer Ibrahim Salahuddin, Assistant Lecturer at the Faculty of Petroleum and the Mining Engineers University in Egypt. And actually, it's a great honor for me to be invited by Streamlines Petroleum Company Training for the Oil and Gas to prepare this short video about the upstream petroleum projects, life cycles, and the value chain. Today we will discuss with each other our industry, not from the technical point of view, but also from the commercial and economical and financial point of view. Before we go to the main topic here, I'd like to present what the meaning of the value chain itself, the industry value chain. Anyone working in our industry knows that our industry value chain is just a linked series of disconnect but interconnected activities, and all of these activities are concerned mainly with the transformation of the crude oils of natural gas into valuable end-user products. And our industry value chain is divided mainly into three different sectors. We have upstream, and we have the midstream, and also we have the downstream. But what's the difference between them? According to our industry, the upstream sector is concerned mainly with exploration and development and production. So in other words, the upstream petroleum industry is just concerned with discovery of the hydrocarbons and bringing these crude materials from subsurface to the surface of the ground. In other words, we concerned with exploration and development and production phases of our projects. And then we have the downstream, which is concerned mainly with transforming all of these products into valuable end-user products, like fuels, like gasolines, like any other types of the fuels which are used daily by consumers. And then we have the midstream, and the midstream, which is concerned mainly with the transportation process of these crude materials into the valuable end-users downstreams. But the most important thing is the investment decisions in any sectors of this value chains. In other words, before you make your decision to invest in any sectors of this value chain, you have first to understand the dynamics or the factors which are affecting the other value chains, because this value chain is highly linked with each other. For example, before you make your decision to invest in the upstream, you first to understand the dynamics of the midstream and the downstream. In other words, what makes any company operating today to invest in the upstream sectors? First of all, we should have opportunity to make a profit, and the profit depends mainly on the market or the downstream sector. So that before we invest in the upstream, we have first to understand the dynamics of the markets in the downstream. And also, what makes any company to invest in the downstream? First of all, we should have opportunity to create the profit, which depends on the needs of the market. And also, before we build any refinery project or regasification plants, for example, in the downstream, we should first have a permanent supply of the crude materials, which depend mainly on the upstream. And also, investing in the upstream and the downstream depend mainly on the midstream or the transportations. How can we transport our products from the upstream to the downstream? So that before we invest in any sectors, we have to understand the dynamic behaviors of other sectors. But in general, we have 13 important factors which affecting our industry. The first of all of them is the demand of the energy. The first main factor is the demand of the energy. The second important factors relating to the profit, which is depending mainly on the prices and also the cost. And finally, we have the government policy, because all of us know that petroleum industry is just a political game between different governments. We have to understand the government policy and the investment environment first before we making our decisions to invest in any sectors of the value chain. But always, as industry leaders, we have an important question, which is what is the target of any upstream petroleum company? What's our target? That question comes to our heads today. What's the target of our industry? Before I'm answering this question, I'd like to say that Our industry is just a gamble game. We invest to win. We take a risk to win. So that our target is not just to find oil or gas. So that our industry target is not just to find large amount of oil or gas, but our target is to make profit, to earn money. How much we will gain for each dollar we are going to invest. So that to remove the first belief from our minds, I'd like to say that discovering large amount of oil or gas, not necessarily that you are going to make profit, because profit depend on commercial success. So that till now we have two different concepts of success or discovery. We have geological discovery and also we have commercial discovery. Geological discovery meaning that you find accumulations of the hydrocarbons, but not necessarily meaning that we are going to gain money or there is income from these accumulations, because the factors that's controlling our commercial success are completely different from the factors controlling the geological success. But the geological success is the first step in our commercial success. But what is meant by commercial success now? The second important question is, does the commercial success meaning that we're finding large accumulation of hydrocarbons? Absolutely no. Commercial success, on the other hand, depend on finding large accumulation, but these accumulations can produce economically for us. This meaning that in our industry, we have 13 and definite criteria called the commerciality criteria. If all of the factors controlling these criteria exist with each other, this meaning that we are going to gain profit. There is income from these resources. First of all, in our commercial criteria, the first important factors according to the petroleum resources management system in the world, we should have a definite field development plan. First of all, you should have a plan to develop your fields. And after that, you should also have the necessary capex or the necessary fund to create this plan. So that first of all, you should have a plan, a definite field development plan in a definite time. And this time nowadays may be up to 5 years, but for large gas accumulation fields, maybe up to 8 to 10 years. The second important factor is that you have the necessary fund. If you have a plan, but you don't have a fund or the capex or the capital that is necessary to create these plans, be sure that you are going to develop your fields. And the third important factor, before you develop your field, you should have a market, or to secure your market to sell your hydrocarbon products. Without the market, you will not have a money. There is no profit from your fields. And the fourth important factors, which also affecting our investment or the commerciality criteria, you should have the necessary transportation means. So, to transport your products from the upstream to this market. This meaning is that the commerciality depends mainly on the value chain itself. The development plan and the necessary fund is related mainly to the upstream sectors, and the market is related mainly to the downstream sectors. And also, without the necessary transportation means, we are not be able to transport our products from the upstream to the downstream. But nowadays we have another important factor, which is called the political environment itself. As I told you, there's geopolitical conflicts in our industry, and most of the reserves nowadays are located in the OPEC, which nowadays suffers from the war, from the wars and instability in its entire conditions. So the final factors, or the most important factor also, which affecting our commerciality criteria, is that you have a stable political environment. All the legal and the contractual environment are favorable for your investment. So before you make your decision to invest in our industry, or before you develop your fields, the commerciality criteria should exist. All of these factors should be existed together. But before I'm going to talk about our industry, I'd like to talk about the different oil and gas companies which exist, or the competitive environment. In our industry, we have different types of companies, but these companies are classified mainly into three different categories. The first of them, we have the integrated oil and gas company. And these integrated oil and gas companies are called IOCs. And these companies are vertically integrated. Vertically integrated, meaning that these companies are operating in the whole sectors of the value chains. These companies operating in both the upstream and the downstream and the midstream. And the major IOCs nowadays are British Petroleum, Chevron, ExxonMobil, and Shell, and Total of France. The second types of the companies we have independents or medium companies. These companies are specialized mainly on one sectors of our value chain, like Heritage Oils or Shorelines or Apache or ConocoPhillips, whatever the names, but these companies are operating only on one sector of these value chains. And the third important category is the national oil and gas companies. These companies belong to the government or the state-owned companies. And the most common NOC in the world, we have Saudi Aramco, and we have NNPC in Nigeria, we have KOC, we have ADNOC, we have national Iranian companies, we have Petrols of Venezuela, and also Petropars of Brazil, and also Gazprom of Russia. We have different national oil and gas companies. And nowadays, these companies control more than 70% of the major resources worldwide. Okay, so we have three different types of companies. But now I'd like to talk about the market structure to understand our industry first. Our market structure, we have two different types of markets. In any industry, we have two different types of markets. We have competitive market, and also we have monopolistic market. In the competitive market, simply we have different players, different actors, but all of them not have sufficient size to influence this market, but each company operates to keep or to preserve its positions. And on the other hand, we have monopolistic market. In the monopolistic markets, we have a single or few actors, and these actors are of sufficient size to control the price or the volumes of the hydrocarbons. But now the question is, what's the type of our market? If our market is a monopolistic market or competitive markets? Simply, the answer depends on which sector we are operating nowadays. If we are talking about commodity markets, we have different types. It may be competitive, like the developed and European and American companies, and may be fully supported by the government. There is subsidy from the governments. Okay, but if we are going to talk about the crude markets, I think OPEC is large enough to influence this market. This market is fully under the control of the oil producing companies nowadays. Now we will talk about the upstream petroleum life cycle. Simply, our cycles, our projects in upstream petroleum projects is divided mainly into six parts. Starting with the acquisition, and then we have exploration, and then we have appraisal, and the most important is the development, and then production and abandonment. This is the whole life cycle of our project, and each part of these life cycles provide a complete description and evaluation of each sector of this game. As I told you, our industry is just a gamble between the government and the oil and gas producing companies. We need to first to understand the structure to win this gamble at the end. If we want to talk about the acquisition sector, in this sector is very, very important, and I'll consider it the most important one. Because in this process, we identify the framework of the financial agreement between the host government and between the companies to obtain the license to produce or to explore for the hydrocarbons. And this stage of our project is very, very important, And because this stage can determine how much we will gain and how much we will pay in the future, how the costs will be shared and how the taxes will be, how can we recover costs after that? This process is very, very important from my point of view. In this process, we identify the physical system between the contractor and the government. In oil and gas industry, we have different types of physical system. We have reality tax, and we have contractual system, and with the contractual system we have production share contract, and we have surface contract. In the surface contract we have pure and risk surface contract. We are going to talk about it in details in the future in other presentations. But at the end, if the negotiations is successful between the host government and between the oil and gas companies, we get our license to or the permission to explore and to produce the hydrocarbons. And this process is very, very important. And the main clauses or provisions in our contracts, including, for example, the area and also the time and also the cost recoveries and the taxes and the realities and also the bonuses, everything relating to the money and also the cost. And if the negotiations are successful, when we negotiations, we come to the second stage of our life cycles, which is talking about the exploration process. In this process of the explorations, our target is just to find any indications about the hydrocarbons, in other words, to make geological success. Simply, the exploration is the activity which characterizes the petroleum industry to be highly risk industry, because simply we are going to invest many several hundreds millions of dollars, and there is no guarantee that if we are going to recover these costs again or no, because in most oil and gas contract the cost is only recovered if there is a commercial discovery. So what makes a company to spend more than $100 million in a single project, and there is not, and there is completely nearly 80% of complete failures, and or there's a probability of success not exceeds 20% nowadays. So that exploration is very, very important, and which is characterized the petroleum industry as a highly risk industry. And the exploration process is divided mainly into two different parts. The first part of the first process is geological and seismic survey, and also after that we have drilling process. Simply, in the first stage of the geological survey or geophysical and seismic survey, our target is just to have indications or to determine the structures about the structures in which the oil and gas is trapped. In our industry, the oil and gas is trapped in certain and definite structures like the anticline. Simply, in our industry, the oil and gas is accumulated in a definite shapes, or it's called, on the other hand, is trapped. For example, we have structure traps like the anticlines, and we have a fault trap. We have other different types of traps. But all of these shapes are well defined by any geological engineer. If we find in the seismic and geological survey, seismic simply is like a sonar for any pregnant woman. Gives us an indication about what exists under the ground. In other words, seismic process this consists mainly of certain operations, like we have a source of the waves and we have receivers. We send the waves, its source may be a dynamite, for example, maybe trucks or different types of sources, but in general we have a source of the waves, and also we have receivers or geophones. And then after we shot the seismic, the waves goes down subsurface and then reflected from subsurface formations and then collected by the receivers, okay, or from this reflections point. In other words, we send waves, and the reflection of this wave depends on the characteristics of the medium under the ground, and then from the reflection of the waves or from its velocity and time of receiving, we can determine the shapes of subsurface formations. For example, say this is the trap under the ground. We have gas and oil and water, and this is the structures. Seismic gives us only an indication about the structure which exists under the ground. If the and this is the structures as indicated by the seismic operations. Look at this and you compare the two structures with each other. You will find that this structure is identical to these structures. If this structure exists under the ground, now we have a probability that in this place or in these locations, there is maybe accumulations for the hydrocarbon in this place. So that's the probability of finding hydrocarbons. Depend on many factors like the structures, like the source rock, like the trapping mechanism. We are going to talk all about these factors later in different videos and in different presentations. But say if we find these structures from the seismic process, this meaning that in this place we have a probability to have accumulations for the hydrocarbons. But seismic gives us only indications about the structures, but we are not sure that if there is hydrocarbon or no. So that's the second stage. If there are structures, we now want to drill the first well to be sure that if there is hydrocarbon or no. So in the drilling operations, we drill a well from the surface to the structure which is existing under the ground to be sure that if there is hydrocarbon or no. But from the decision-making process point of view, some companies may drill the wells even if there is no structures. And some companies that are not drill the wells even if there are structures. It depends on your decision-making mechanism and the level of your risk which existing in your projects. Because the cost of the drilling operation is very, very high. Nowadays, it may be more than $100 million in some offshore drilling locations. And we are going to talk about how can we drill an oil well later in the future. But this is just a simple shape about the oil wells, starting with larger diameter pipe and get smaller as we go deeper, and finally to the protection zones, like a telescope when you spread it. And the problem for us is not how can we drill the well, but the problem is if we are going to drill the well or no, to make the decision of the drilling process. But say we make the decision to drill the well, now there is important question after we finish drilling. The first important question, does the well is successful or no? Or in other words, if we have made a geological success or no. If there is any indications of the hydrocarbon or no. And if there is, the answer is yes, this meaning that we have a discovery. The second important question is what kind of fluids we are going to produce. So after we finish the drilling operations, we have to answer two important questions. The first one, if the well is successful or no. The second question, if the well is successful, we are going which kind of fluid we are going to produce. So that after we finish drilling, we come to the stage of the evaluation process. In the evaluation process, we use certain well bore hole measurements to evaluate the characteristics of subsurface formations. We make a certain measurement by certain tools which are well defined to anyone working in our industry. We have different techniques to evaluate our formations, but the most common techniques are, the first of all, is the mud logging, which gives you an indication about the stratigraphic columns and the geology in these regions. And the second important one is the core analysis and the scale process. And also we have some productivity tests such as drill stem test and well test analysis. And the most important one is the wireline logs or petrophysical logging. But at the end, the main target here is to evaluate whether a certain region or this trap or this structure has a hydrocarbon or no. And finally, the most important data that we need to know is we need to know the data about the reservoir itself. We need to know the pay zone thickness and also some technical data like porosities, like saturations and the kinds of flows. And we are going to talk about all of them in details later, the technical data that we need from our projects. But at the end, our target after we finished the exploration programs is to determine how much hydrocarbon exists in your place. And how much is depend on the technical data, like the area, like thickness, like process, like saturations. And anyone working in our industry know exactly what's meant by need by thickness, what means by porosity, what's meant by saturations, and the drainage area and enclosure and everything. But we now finished our exploration programs, we come to the third stage of appraisal. Now, before we talking about the appraisal stage of our project, I'd like to say that the data which we obtained from the exploratory wells not represent the whole reservoirs. These data are not representative at all, because this data only represent itself, represent the region surrounding the well, a very narrow regions surrounding the wells. But we are not sure that if this data represents the whole reservoir or no, if this reservoir is going to be homogeneous or heterogeneous, and so that we have a lack in our data. But now we are sure that we have accumulation in these regions, so that now we want to know more and more. In the appraisal process, we get more and more data about our reservoirs. In this process, appraisal or delineation wells are drilled to collect the cost-effective information to determine exactly the size of the oil and gas field, and also to decide if and how to develop these reservoirs most efficiently. Or in other words, in the appraisal phase, we drill more wells, and these wells are distributed laterally from the exploratory wells around the reservoir itself. And the main target here is to make a complete picture or have a complete image about our reservoirs, to know everything relating to our reservoirs, its lithology and its mineralogy, its technical properties, its driving mechanisms, the type of the flow. Because according to these data, we are going to prepare our field development process. And after we finish the appraisals, and after we collect the required data, we come to the fourth stage in the field development process. In the field development process, simply we evaluate different options or multiple development options for the field and selecting the most efficiently plan to efficiently deplete our reservoirs. In the development process, we determine the number of the development wells and their distributions, and also the surface facilities or the surface production facilities and any system required for the transport of the fluid. And the development process is very, very critical and complex process, and passes through different stages. We have different stages to make a good and efficient plan of our fields. The first important stage is the exploratory studies or the opportunity studies. And then the second stage of our process, we have preliminary studies, and then we have conceptual studies, and finally we have preliminary design. In the exploratory studies, as I told you, first of all, we have to evaluate our reservoir from the technical point of view. In the exploratory studies, we evaluate whether a particular object being explored is potentially prospective or no from the technical point of view. During this stage, we evaluate the reservoir from the technical point of view. We evaluate the probability range of the volume of the hydrocarbons, because each company has its own technical criteria, according to which we can say that this reservoir is technically prospective for us or no, which is called cutoff properties. For example, some companies say that if the permeability is less than one millidarcy, this meaning that this reservoir is tight and this technical is not technically valuable for us from the technology point of view. Some companies say that the reservoir has a reprost more than certain value, less than certain value, this meaning that this reservoir is not prospective for us, and so on. In this process, we evaluate the technical criteria of our reservoirs. For example, after collecting the data from the exploratory wells and the appraisal wells, now we have a probability range of each data. For example, we have the formation thickness, the net pay thickness, and also we have porosities and water saturations and drainage area and recovery factor and all of this. And then all of these data are integrated to each other to calculate how much hydrocarbon existing in place by this equation. This process, we are going to talk about in great details after that. But till now, all of these data are integrated with each other in these equations by using different softwares like Monte Carlo simulation or at-risk softwares, different softwares we use it. And now if you examine it, each data or each parameter here can be used to calculate how much hydrocarbon, but we have density distributions or density data for each parameter here. This meaning that we have also a distributions of how much hydrocarbon existing in place from this equation. So that all of these equations are used to run or perform a risk analysis or uncertainty analysis to get the distributions of how much hydrocarbon existing in place. Okay, and then we determine our probability for each accumulation, the cumulative probability. In other words, we convert these distributions into cumulative distribution by using the area under the curve. We have two different techniques. For example, we have may using more than or equal or less than or equal. For example, if we're talking about what's the probability that all the reserve or all the hydrocarbon in place is more than or equal this reserve, it meaning that all of the hydrocarbons existing here has all of the hydrocarbon existing here or the area under the curve. So if we're using more than or equal, the lowest reserve will have a cumulative probability of 100%. And if I told you that what is the cumulative probability that your reserve will be more than or equal this, we have a zero probability here because it's the maximum reserve or the maximum hydrocarbon existing here, and also and so on. So that we have a probability or cumulative probability curve. And another, the second technique is using less than or equal. If I told you that what's the probability that all the hydrocarbons that we have is less than or equal this, zero probability, we don't have any hydrocarbons less than or equal this. But if I told you what the probability, if I asked you what's the probability that all the hydrocarbons is less than or equal this value, this meaning that we have 100%. So we have two different types of the curves like this. We have a curve of more than or equal or the less than or equal, whatever the curve. Okay, that's the cumulative curve. We convert this curve into this curve at the end. And now, according to our policy, we want to determine if we are going to develop this field or not. For example, this curve is used for the reserve, and I'm going to talk later about what's the difference between resource and reserve, okay, and the different types of resources, and if the reserve is a type of resource or no, and the prospective reserve and everything. This is just introduction or just overview about our industry to show you how the decisions are made. And then if we have this cumulative curve, some companies using three different types of probability. This curve represents more than or equal. We have 10% cumulative probability, we have 50% cumulative probability, and we have 90% cumulative probability. If this curve is prepared for the reserve, if the probability is 90% more than or equal, we're talking about proved reserve. If the probability is 50%, we're talking about proved plus probable or 2p reserve. If we're talking about 10%, we talk about 3p or proved probable and possible reserve. This is just to show you how the decisions are made, if we are going to develop the field or not, if this field is technically viable for us or not. And according to some companies using 50% probability to make their decision, if this is 50%, that's more than certain value, and according to the market conditions, this curve is favorable for us. So our decisions depend on the probability and the reserve opposite each probability. And all of these data are got from the explorations and the appraisal phase of our projects. Now, say our reservoirs are technically viable for us. We come to the second stage of our process, which is called the preliminary studies. Now our accumulations is technically viable. Now we check the economical or the commercial viability of our projects. In the second stage, in the preliminary studies, we evaluate the economic and commercial feasibility of our projects. Now we evaluate the technical viability. Now we evaluate the commercial and economic viability according to the market conditions. We determine how many wells we are going to produce or to drill, sorry, and also if the well is going to be recovered to the surface by the nature driving forces, or which types of the artificial lift you are going to use in the future. If the fluid's characteristics are corrosive, that will need more costs to cover our pipes and so on. So that in the preliminary studies, in brief, we determine if our field is going to be economical or not from our commercial point of view. And if the field is now technically viable and also economical value, now our field is a target for us to be developed. And after we evaluate the technical viability and also the commercial viability, now we come to the third stage of conceptual studies. In the conceptual studies, we determine the best options according to the cost and the value engineering to determine the best plan or the most feasible plan from the technical and economical point of view. In this process, we determine the best plan according to the expected production volumes, according to the necessary investment costs and also operating costs, and the economic feasibility of our project and the time needed, and also according to the technical and operating and the financial risk. We select the best plan of all of this. And also we are going to talk about it later in different phases, the difference between the cost engineering and also the value engineering, and how can we determine the best plan for the field development. But these are the most important factors that we consider during preparing the best plan. For example, to show you an example of this, we have different strategies for producing the fields. We have depletion strategy, natural depletions, and also have different production strategy, different artificial lift strategy, different perforating strategy. To make the situation easier, say for example we discover an offshore oil field and now we want to develop this field. We have three different options. For example, the first option to develop an offshore field is to build a standalone platform, just a platform for this field. So okay, that's one option. And the second option is to using a tieback option to an existing platform. There is a platform nearby and just we need a tieback facilities to connect the production from this field to the old one. That's the second option. And the third option is we can using FPSO methods to produce this field, which is commonly used in Ghana and also in Nigeria. So that if we discover which option of all of these options is the most feasible for us and the more economic for us, we have to select among these options. Now we select the best option to develop the field. We are going to using a standalone platform. Now, in the third stage, after we determine the best plan, we are going to use standalone platform. And during each stage, we estimate roughly the costs. We have different techniques to estimate the cost. We have conceptual techniques, such as comparing like with like, and also we have scaling techniques. We have different techniques to estimate the cost and also the contingency during each phase in our projects. And then we have also the most important one, after we agreed on the plan, we comes to the cost estimation by what we call a detailed estimation method or unit estimation method, by which we can estimate the cost of each item. So we comes after that to the preliminary design stage. In the preliminary design stage, in this process, we make a complete design or semi-detailed design for the final concept, which is selected later. And also we prepare a detailed reservoir model. And the controlling factors during this process is the quality and the cost and the time. And after we prepare the final or semi-detailed design, we also develop what we call a schedule and timetable for the necessary activities, for the necessary plan to determine the necessary budget. And this process is very, very important, or sometimes called the pre-feed and the feed stage, because after this stage we call for tenders to determine our EPC contractors and so on. But the most important thing that I'd like to talk about it is the field development team itself, the team which is responsible for preparing the best efficient plan. The field development team simply is a highly integrated team with multidisciplinary teams with varied experience and qualification and skills. and these teams work together to develop the best plan and allocate this plan according to our budget and time and the human resources. This team is highly, highly integrated and is highly skilled team. Simply, the development team is like this. We have reservoir engineering, we have geologist engineer, we have drilling engineer, completion engineer, and the production engineer, and also facility and also safety engineer, and the economic expert to say that this project is economic or not, or to perform our feasibility studies. So that this team is highly integrated team. And after we select our the best contractor to develop our field, and also we make the best plan, and also we determine everything relating to the plan from the time and from the schedule and from the activity point of view. We come to the final stage of our development process, which is called the FID, or the final investment decisions. Before we award our engineering and the procurement and the construction contract, we have to make sure that everything is suitable and everything exists. And the most critical factors which are affecting our final decisions is the government approvals. We have to make sure that we have all the government approvals, and also we have to secure our sales and purchasing agreement, and also all the financial agreement which are necessary for our projects. If anything is missed from all of these three factors, this may delay our award of our EPC contracts later, because we can't award our contract without securing our financing agreement, and also we can't award our EPC contract without obtaining all the government approvals, and also we have to secure our sales and purchasing agreement. And also in some cases for large or huge gas fields, we have to secure our market first. And all of these factors are very, very important before we award our contract. And we have different techniques and different mechanisms or different types of contracts. We have conventional contracts, and also we have integrated contracts. We have different techniques. And we have also different methods to select the best contractors. And all of this will be included later in different projects. And once we get our FID, or the final investment decisions, everything is okay now. Now we are going to develop our plan. The second phase in our project is the field development execution process. In this process, our engineers prepare the detailed design for our plans, because that is a preliminary design are really sufficient to allow the EPC contract to begin their procurement and construction activities. In this process, in the detailed design, we prepare a highly detailed or a fully detailed design for everything relating to our tools and equipment. And after that, the contractor starts their procurement and the construction agreement. And finally, after we finish all of the required phases for our projects, we come to the commissioning phase in our project, in which we test our facilities to ensure that they have been constructed according to the original design and are capable of operating as planned. In this process, we have different testing mechanisms like pressure testing, equipment cleanout, and the checks installations, everything, and the mechanical performance for every phase in the commissioning process. Now our field is developed, our plan is created, and after that we come to the production phase in our project. In the production phase, now our wells are put on stream and the production comes to the surface, and we sell this production, and then we gain revenue from the sales of our productions. But during this phase, we have to keep our production at certain levels, and through that, the production and the performance monitoring is required to upgrade and to modify the project from time to time. We may need to make any artificial lifts techniques or any secondary or tertiary recovery methods to ensure or to keep our production at certain levels, and to increasing our productions from our reservoirs, or to get from the reservoir as we can. Simply, in the production phase, we have to understand the mechanism by which the reservoirs is producing, and also we have to select the most optimum way to increasing the production from our reservoirs during our decline period. Because simply the production profile from our reservoirs, from any reservoirs, will be like this. In the early stage, we have built up method in which the production is going up from our reservoirs when the wells are bottom stream. And after that, we have many years of the plateau period in which the production is keep constant during the 3 years. And after that, when there is a high dissipation in the reservoir energy, the productions begin to decline. And the decline phase in our project is very, very important. And always we have to keep our decline rates very, very narrow to be sure that we extract from the reservoir the greatest amount as we can. And finally, we come to the economic limit. In the economic limit, as we'll talk later during the economic sessions, is that at the economic limit, there is no more revenue comes from our reservoirs, at which all the costs is equal to the revenue gain. And our abandonment, then we come to the abandonment process in which we abandon our fields. And I want to say that our abandonment decisions not depend on the technical recovery from our reserve. Our abandonment decisions depend mainly on the economic recovery from our reserves, which is in turn depend on the market behaviors. And our industry is a highly risky industry, not for many factors due to the high degree of uncertainty, but the most important factors affecting our industry is the high volatility in the oil and the gas prices, which affecting our economic behavior and the economic life and the economic limit of our reservoirs. During this process, we try to do anything just to extend the economic life of our fields by reducing the costs, by using any processing agreement, or by renegotiation against the physical costs. As I told you, our decision here to abandon the field or no depending mainly on the economic recovery from our fields, which is affected by the prices and also affecting by the physical costs. As I told you, the operator or the company, if the field is not economic for any part, if any contracting parts, any part has the complete freedom to abandon this field, okay? So during this process is very, very critical for any oil and gas company and also for any government. But say we have there is no more revenue comes from our reserves, from our reservoir, so we make the decision to abandon the field. In the abandonment process, should be accomplished according to the government regulations. As you know, we're operating with chemicals, our hydrocarbons are poisons in some cases, so the abandonment decisions or the abandonment of our fields should be progressed according to the government regulations. And actually, we have several companies operating in this area of the abandonment of the field, and in exchange for the salvage value of all of the existing equipment. And also, but the most important thing here, for successful removals or abandonment of our fields, we begin to plan for this stage many years before this time comes. Because the abandonment is a highly costly process, the cost of abandonment is very, very high. We have to prepare ourselves for this process. We have to keep the money several years before this time comes to be available during this period of time. Simply, this is just a short introduction about our industry and the project life cycles and the value chain of our projects. And actually, I'd like to thank Streamlines for allowing me to give this presentation and short video for anyone who is interested in our industry. And I wish to give more and more presentations in different times to cover each sector covered in this presentation in great detail. I wish to see all of you later. Thank you.